Bruce Kimmel. I am the president of something called LACCTAA, which is the Los Angeles City College Theater Academy Alumni Association. And normally I would stand out there because we were very well trained in the school to be, to project and be orator. But at my age, you only get aura in the top. Anyway, this theater next year, the Camino Theater, is this whole building is 50 years old. I was in the class that helped them move in here. I began coming to the school 50 years ago, which is amazing because I'm only 32.
I was here 50 years ago.
You were there 50 years ago, too.
And I saw Pepe and St. Louis.
And God bless you for that. So what? Very exciting. Have nothing to do with this department, but God bless you. So it is such a treat to be here tonight and to have this evening. I met Richard Sherman back in 1997, I believe, and he will talk about that story because it's funny. And he has since become one of my dearest friends. And we have been doing these events for the last 5 or 6 years here, bringing in really wonderful people to the college. So I don't think we should have any further ado. Will you please welcome my very, very good friend, Richard M. Sherman. Let's start at the very beginning, which is a very good place to start. Where did you grow up? Just tell us a little bit about your childhood and how you and your brother Robert first got interested in music.
Right. Well, actually, it was an atmosphere that I lived in, an environment. I was born in New York City a long, long time ago, and my dad was a songwriter and played the piano all the time. My mother was an actress, but she had given up acting, and she played beautiful piano. She was classically trained. And so music was in the family all the time. We moved out to Southern California in 1938, late 37, early 38. And I've been a Californian ever since. So I kind of adopted California. But basically, I grew up in California.
All right then. And who, as you were growing up and getting interested in music, who were your influences in those early years? Songwriters you really responded to?
Oh, well, that's a very good question. First of all, I really never was aware of the fact that I was being very much influenced, but the music that was in the house all the time was the finest of popular music and show music. All the time, my father would bring home records, and I would listen to things like, I listened to the trio, the Benny Goodman trio, and I would listen to things like Whispering and Tiger Rag, and these incredible pieces of jazz. And I would listen to these things, and my dad would say, "That is art." And I was a little boy, but it was just great. So I grew up with that. When I was a little boy, my mom and dad took me to see a show. And the show was called Showboat. You might have heard of it. a little show. It was a revival of the great Showboat. And when that music started, that great, great Jerome Kern music started playing, and I was listening to Old Man River and all these incredible songs, I started crying. I mean, I was so emotionally gripped and worn and exalted by it. And I remember my father looked at my mom and said, "Oh, he's another one of them." Okay. They sort of recognized I had a kind of an affinity towards music, popular songs, and show songs, yeah.
So what were, when you finally decided to start writing with your brother, what were the first songs you wrote, and at what point did somebody take an interest?
Well, actually, that all came about in a very interesting way. When I was in college, I was writing songs for the show and for the plays and special material, and I was very influenced by Noel Coward and by Rodgers and Hart. Those are my two heroes. And Cole Porter. Cole Porter, my God, I just worshiped everything he wrote. And so I had all these influences, and I was trying to write in that wonderful, elegant style with wonderful linguistic turns and twists. And it was all kind of fun, except terribly uncommercial. And so, and so by the time I got out of college, I was sort of trying to write the great American novel, a musical, all by myself. And I was digging a great American hole in the ground. And my brother had gotten out of college, and he wanted to be a writer. He wanted to just write plays and write books. And so he was writing the great American novel and digging a hole in the ground. And one day, our dad, God bless him, came to our little tiny apartment. We lived over a cleaning store on Pico Boulevard, West Pico Boulevard. And he sat down for about 2 minutes, and he said, "You know, you two guys with your college educations, I bet you don't have enough intelligence to put together your brains and write a little pop song that some kid would give up his lunch money to buy." And he just walked out of the room. As they say, the gauntlet was thrown. And Bob and I looked at each other and said, we could write a song together. And so we started listening to the radio. For the first time, listening to what popular music was, as opposed to me trying to write elegant, super colossal, fancy songs, and my brother trying to write his novel. We were trying to come up with a good story that could be sold on a record that a kid would give his lunch money up to buy. And we tried. Dad would come over every once in a while, listen to what we were doing, trying to encourage us and give pointers to us. He was a great influence. And finally, we did come up with one little commercial song idea, and he helped us tool it and fancy it and twist it to make it really work. And that was our first published song.
And do you remember what it was?
Yes, I remember it vividly. The name of the song was "Gold Can Buy Anything But Love." Because country music was very big in that day. And this was a very country kind of a song. And we had the twist, which was, it's very provocative to say, gold can buy anything, but love, you can't buy love. That was the following line. And so we had this little song, and a publisher liked it. Our dad sort of told us that there's a certain publisher in town that you might want to go to. I think he let him know ahead of time that we were coming. But we didn't know that. But we went to him, and he liked the song very much. And our very first recording was by Gene Autry. It was a great, great recording. So our very first recording was none other than Gene Autry, the sort of the king of Western music at that time. And we were very excited about the fact we got this record, and it looked like it was going to be a big hit. But there's a twist to that story, because what happened was, it was 1951, and General MacArthur had been recalled from leading the army in Korea, because he had disobeyed orders and gone over the 48th parallel. This is history, but this has something to do with me, because he went over the 48th parallel, so Harry Truman, President Truman, called him back to the States and said, "You've been a bad boy, you can't run the army anymore." And so MacArthur retired, and he made a speech, and this has all to do with my song, truly, because he made a speech, and he concluded his speech by saying, "And I want to end my years reciting an old army ballad that we used to sing back in the barracks in the army at West Point. Old soldiers never die, they just fade away." Overnight, Gene Autry recorded, "Old soldiers never die, they just fade away," and our song faded away rapidly.